So, I would say we start. I will do a short introduction. So, in case some people are still coming to this lecture room, they still have 5 minutes until we have like the real content. So, welcome from my side. It's a little more than 25 people here that are actually enrolled. The reason is because some of you seem to be willing to learn Python, even though the school doesn't give you credit for it. So, I'm stunned that it's that many people that want to learn this on their own in their free time. So either you have too much free time, or it's just a topic that you're super interested in. First of all, you see the red light here. That means once you see the red light, that means everything is taped in here. So even if you talk to your neighbor, you can hear it. And that means you should be careful in what you say. And I think that's a good thing, because back when I was studying here, we didn't have this really. So what this meant is that, you know, after like 10, 15 minutes in a lecture, when we found it was a bit too boring, we might, you know, end up doing some other stuff and talk to our neighbor, and we would not focus so much. So I think the red light might be very helpful in helping you to focus. And also, because I know from my own experience as well that focusing for 3 hours nonstop is rather hard to do, we decided to split this lecture into 90-minute sessions. That is also different from the normal 3-hour lectures that you're used to. So this is just, you know, from experience, we tried several different formats for this course, and I think having 90-minute sessions works best. And also note that in the previous semester, we ran this course over a longer stretch, so it was like 12, 13 weeks in total, with one lecture a week. This semester, we have 2 90-minute sessions per week, so the intensity is a bit higher. And I think that's good, because one of the criticisms in last semester was, we kind of felt like we did our homework, we worked hard for 2 days, and then we had to wait for like 3, 4 days until the next lecture. So we increased the intensity a bit. I still took care of the schedule such that it does not overlap with your exams. So that's why we already have this first session, or the first 3 sessions actually, in this quarter and not in the next quarter, because this is actually a Q4 course, and we start, as you notice, in Q3. And the reason is because we just have 3 lectures now, then we stop, and you can take care of your other exams, and then we will come back, and then we will be done by the first week of April already, long before your other exams, which means none of you has any excuse in telling me you didn't have time to do homework or to do reading or whatever. And this is basically done so that you have the best environment to study, because in order to program, you have to do programming. You cannot just wait until the exam 2 days prior and start studying. This won't work. So, a little bit to my person. Some of you already called me your professor. I'm not a professor, so please don't call me professor. That's a joke that, you know, is not funny, because I don't know. As long as you're not done with your PhD, you shouldn't use any title for legal reasons, A, but also maybe, you know, you're not lucky and you won't make the PhD. I don't know. So don't call me professor, don't call me doctor, because I'm none of that. I'm a PhD student, that's it. So what qualifies me to give this course? Well, I would say there are 3 main points that you need to know. The first one is, I open my LinkedIn profile, you can read up the stuff, the details later. But the first point is, I'm one of you. So I did not study computer science. I studied at some other university upstream the river in my bachelor's before coming to this good university here. And I did my master's, and that was already back in 2012. So, and back then, there was no master in finance, there was only master in management. We had 2 electives, 2 concentrations, it was called. I had finance and supply chain management. So I have not studied anything other than you might be doing. The second reason is, after my master's, I left the university to co-found a company in Berlin, a startup. The startup is still active, even though we never made money, which is the case for most startups, but it's still there, it exists. And back when we started in 2014, we had one big problem, we didn't find coders. So I talked to my co-founder and I said, you know, what about this? You give me like 3 months, I go to some hole, I start studying, you won't see me for 3 months, I will come back, I will do all of the coding. And he said, yeah, that's a long time, 3 months, but you know, it's better than, you know, looking for coders that might not even stay or that are too expensive or whatever. So that's what we did back then. And the good thing is, if you are a self-taught programmer, is you will make every mistake you can possibly make when coding. So when we launched our first app back in 2016, it worked, but the code was super buggy. And over time, you know, once you understand the limitations of your code, when you, you know, want to add a new feature or something, then you really know what you did wrong. And once you understand what you did wrong in practice, then you know how to teach it right. So that's a big advantage, I think. And then the third reason is, as you noted, I'm a PhD student. And yeah, so I do nothing but coding for the last 3 to 4 years. And I'm focusing on parts of my studies are on machine learning applications and logistics and route optimization, which are, you know, quite hard topics in terms of coding. So I think I learned a lot of that stuff in theory as well. And that's basically all you need to know. So I hopefully will be done with the PhD sometime this year. But for now, as I said, I'm a nobody, basically. Okay, so what else do you need to know about this course? There is Moodle, and I was asked by the digitization department to put everything on Moodle, so I did. And I think all of you should have access. If you don't, then let me know. And then what will you see on Moodle? Well, basically, you have one ribbon here for every lecture. So the first three lectures are already online. You have an intro section. And in the intro section, you find basically the syllabus, if you scroll down, the deliverables right here. And but I will also give you announcements whenever you are, you know, required to do something. You see the schedule. What you see here is a lot of room E102. Depending on how many of you are going to stay, we will probably get rid of E102 and replace it with IPC for more seating. And that's basically it. And then in every section, and that includes the intro part, you will see mandatory reading. And when you click on that, what happens is you end up on the GitHub repository where you find all the materials. So that's basically the main side of this course because it has all the materials. And then what you can do, most of you have done this already, you can just download the materials. And I also show you one more link to that. It's the releases thing here. This is where you can see what is the current version. So yesterday, I published the version 0.6.2. And I think when most of you downloaded this, it was, you know, version 0.6.1. So most likely, before every lecture, I will make some updates. And you will always know that you have the right version by checking the latest version here. OK. And then regarding installation, I think most people got it right. And for those of you who didn't, you can write me an email, and then we'll try to figure out why it doesn't work on your machine. And then also one last admin note here. I'm not going to use JupyterLab in the classroom presentations, but you should use JupyterLab. I'm using a similar tool called Jupyter Notebook. It's a little bit different. It's a bit leaner, and I prefer to use it for presentation mode. But just don't be confused that some of the stuff looks different on my machine than it does on yours. And also, I don't know how many of you have a Linux operating system. So whenever I do something here, really don't be confused. It's a different operating system. There's nothing you should worry about. So let's start the zeros lecture. So what's the objective of this course? The objective is to give you some foundation with which you can continue to study anything that requires you to know some programming skills. That means in this university, you have courses, for example, by Professor Massmann, econometrics. You have courses by Professor Spindler called Analytics Edge. You have probably more courses junior professor Browser has a web mining course also starting next quarter. So many, many courses require you to know a little bit of programming. And usually what they do is they teach you some theory, you know, maybe some machine learning stuff or some web mining algorithm and so on. And you basically look at the example code and then you just, you know, copy paste it, you understand it as you go along, but you don't have a real foundation. So this course is about giving you some more background knowledge so that it's easier to do work in more advanced topics. We use Python here. I know some other professors here, they use R. It's a similar language, and anything that can be done in R could also be done in Python, and anything that can be done in Python could also be done in R. So the concepts are also very much the same, even though it's, of course, a different language. So that's the objective of this course, get you ready for some other things. So what are Jupyter Notebooks and why am I using them here? So as you see, I'm in a web browser, Google Chrome, basically. So I'm in a web browser running some stuff. And that's the application that's called Jupyter. And Jupyter, no matter, you know, independent of you using either lab or me using the notebook version, can open a format called Jupyter Notebooks. And Jupyter Notebooks, you see in the repo, are all files that end with IPyNB, which stands for IPython Notebook, which is the old name for Jupyter Notebook. And these formats you can open in this application in your web browser. There are also other applications that can open this, but that's one way of, you know, looking at this. And the important thing is, for those of you who might have some, you know, other programming knowledge already, this is not the only way to do Python programming. There's also a way to put the code in real.py text files where you just have code. That's the more professional way. But since this is a beginner's course, I choose the Jupyter Notebook format because we can combine code with actual, you know, English text and so on, and pictures and videos, as we will see. So this is supposed to make it a little bit easier for you to read through the materials. And it's also self-contained. So meaning, you, as you have already seen, when you do the reading at home, you can actually go through the materials and execute the code, play with the code. That's what it's supposed to do for you. And there's an alternative, which if I did this, most of you would be scared. We could also work in a terminal window, but that's a little bit more advanced. But this would basically be what you would learn if you stick longer with programming. There's no way really around doing some stuff in the terminal. And the terminal, even though it looks scary at first, it's not really scary, okay? So whenever you see me doing something in the terminal, then yeah, just accept it. And there are easy tutorials to learn this as well. It's nothing hard also. And then, of course, as I said, in this document, Jupyter Notebook, we can execute code. So that's the first line of Python code in this course. I execute it. And I just print out hello world. So that's really pointless to do, but it's basically the introduction example that is usually done in every programming course independent of the language. And the nice thing about Python is that basically even a beginner with no knowledge can understand it because it kind of says, well, print something, and then it says what to print within parentheses. We know parentheses already from functions in math, so the syntax, the grammar, is kind of the same here, or similar, so it's not so hard to read. And we will see a lot more of this, of course. Then one short note on some terms that I think are important. So this is a programming course. The title says Intro to Python and Programming. What this course is not, it's not a computer science course, and it's also not an IT course. So these are three different things. And for my understanding, what I say, programming is basically the art of expressing some computation in a programming language. That's my definition of it. It's always specific. There is no abstract, you know, concepts, or there's no abstract notation about it. It always solves a particular problem. Computer science is what you are here not studying. This is if you went to some other university, to the computer science department, you would learn, for example, something about algorithms. You would study them in a mathematical way. So you would do proofs. You would, you know, it's basically math at the end of the day. And so it's something different. And then IT, I just note that IT is anything where I think that has to do with managing, let's say, hardware in a company, that has to do with managing, for example, a knowledge-based system in a company. That goes into what I would consider IT, but this is not what we are doing here. So you're not going to learn how to set up, I don't know, a SQL database or a Tableau server or whatever. That's not what we do here. That's what IT would be. We just learn to program. So you might ask yourself, why Python? Just judging by the number of guest students here, I would say I don't have to convince you that Python is a super cool language to learn, but I want to give you some more reason about. So why did I choose Python back in the year 2014 when we started the startup? So with my limited knowledge back then, I figured, okay, let's do a survey. What languages do I need? What can I do with what languages? And then you will almost certainly get to know that there is a language called JavaScript, which is super important if you want to build some web application, because nothing in your web browser runs without JavaScript. Then you will read about Java, which is something totally different, which is a language that, you know, is commonly used by big enterprises to write software. And yeah, but you know, it's usually old software, usually, you know, big enterprise software written in Java. Then you have some niche programming languages, for example, R, that is basically built, or MATLAB for this purpose, that is basically designed to do numerical computing, to basically do what you learn in a math course in an automated fashion for you, for bigger matrices, for example, and stuff like that. Then I figured, okay, what are we building? We are building an app, an Android app, an iPhone app. So the next thing you do is, what programming language does your iPhone support? And these will be in other languages. What language is run on Android is still a different language. So the question I asked myself back then was, isn't there one language with which I can do a lot of these things? You know, maybe not in the very best way, but maybe a language that keeps me flexible as a company. Because if you have a company and you have 10 programming languages, you might end up with 10 different developers that don't really understand what they're doing each other. So you want to streamline this process. And back then already, I understood that, okay, in Python, I can build backends. And backends are important to power, you know, your iPhone, your Android app, and so on. With Python, you can also do numerical analysis. So back then, we collected data about the art market, and we had to run some analysis, like what's the, you know, average price. So we had to build price prediction models and so on. You can do that in Python. Then I figured we had to build scrapers because we had to like aggregate data on the web. And the question is, what language is good to do that? Well, answer is Python. So the reason why I chose Python back then is to keep the company flexible so that we have as few languages as possible to do the most different things. Because I figure if you're a startup, you need to be agile. So if the answer to, like, let's say we need a new feature by next week is we cannot build this feature because the guy that wrote it is gone and nobody understands, you know, Java or whatever this language that this person programmed in, that's not good for the company. So in order to keep your company flexible, I think you have to keep the number of programming languages to a minimum. And also, a company called Google has the same approach. So they basically have three dedicated languages that any programmer can use at any time without asking a manager. But any other than those three languages, if they want to program in it, some project, whatever it is, even a very small project, they have to get approval. So, and Python is among those languages, and Python is also one of the first languages Google used. So there are many, many reasons. And then regarding Python in particular, Python, to make all of this possible, it was designed to be a so-called general purpose language. So people are often confused when I tell them I can write a web page basically, or I can generate a web page basically in Python. I was asked this question, why don't you use Ruby? Because at this university, you also have other web design or web development courses that is taught in Ruby. I say, well, Ruby is a good language, but the thing about Ruby is you can only do web development. You cannot do anything else. In Python, you can do anything you can do in Ruby, plus a whole lot more. So that was the reason why we chose it back then. And then, of course, there are some other aspects. For example, Python is what is called open source. So the term open source is super important. It has for most of you, you would think, okay, it doesn't cost money. It's free. That's what open source is the equivalent of. But open source means a whole lot more. In particular, it means you can read the source code because it's open. And why would that be important? Well, it's super important if you want to, let's say, put your data in a database and you ask yourself the question, is the encryption that we encrypt our data, is it working? And how do you know? If you use someone else's code, and that's usually what you do, then you have to rely on what they tell you. And if someone else tells you, okay, my code is, it encrypts your data, it's secure, then you have to just rely on it, or you have to check it. And one way of checking it, I would say of mass checking it maybe, is to use open source software, because if an open source software project grows big, you have usually tens of thousands of people using it and reading the source code. And for example, if an organization like, let's say, the NSA or the CIA tried to build in some backdoor somewhere, people would see it. So they actually tried. And the FBI back then, in, I think, Windows XP, that was in the early 2000s, they actually had already a backdoor built into Windows. And officially back then. And so what do you do if you buy a software product where you know there's a backdoor in it? What do you do? And with open source, many hackers and also organizations like the NSA try to put something in there. At the end of the day, people saw it, and then it was not even accepted. So that's a way of making software secure. The same holds true for bugs. So if software is usually buggy, and let's say you find a bug in your Mac operating system, what do you do? Call Apple and say something doesn't work. And then what would Apple do? They would say, yeah, we noted it. And then half a year later, maybe someone fixes it. You have no chance to fix it on your own. Let's say if you're a programmer and you download some open source project and there is something in there that doesn't work, you can fix it right now. And then, of course, the last reason what I put in bold here is Python is also able to work with big amounts of data. And that is also something that I will put a lot of emphasis in the course to teach you concepts that allow you to work with big amounts of data. And now the question is, what is big data? What are typical definitions? One definition could be, for example, what do you do if the data you work with, for example, I work for my research, I work with a company called Foodora, and I got a database from them, which is roughly 110 gigabytes of data. So I have a super, good workstation in my office, but it only holds like 32 gigabytes in memory. So what do you do in this case if the data you want to analyze doesn't fit into your computer's memory? Also, what do you do if the data is so big that if you do some analysis, by the time you get the result back, the data has changed so much that the result doesn't mean anything anymore? For example, if Google looks at the data, the searches in the last 5 minutes, how long does it take to make this analysis? And once you get the result back, what does it tell you about the next minute? So would you need to look at the last 2 minutes again to do the same analysis because the result has just changed? So there are many fields of application, and Python can actually work in all of them. And then lastly, who uses it? This is a short slide of big companies and also NASA. NASA, by the way, if you talk about big data, there is no field that has more data than astronomy. So when people that are astronomers, for example, from the NASA, when they work with data coming from telescopes, that they actually have so much data, they cannot even store all the data they get in. So you can actually learn as a data scientist a whole lot from NASA. Then that's a graph that's very basically, I've just put it in because as business people, we like graphs going up. And that is the development of Python in terms of measured as search requests on Stack Overflow. And we see that Python just grew tremendously, even in a niche market here. Three tips about how do you learn to program. First one is what I call ABC rule. It stands for always be coding. So that's why you get lots of exercises in this course, because we can talk as long as we want all day. As long until you don't code, you won't learn anything, right? Another big thing, make a schedule. That's by one of the co-founders of Y Combinator, Paul Graham. And he wrote, it's an old blog post that is referenced also in the materials. And it's really worthwhile reading. He says there are two types of people, who manage stuff, managers. They have to meet people for business lunch or meetings. They manage their schedule on an hourly basis, maybe even half hourly basis. And then there's makers, people that work in a creative way. And that does not necessarily mean programmers. It is also like your average artist. Sometimes artists, they go to an island for 4 weeks and they come back and have a new painting. And they couldn't do this back home because they just don't have the leisure in their mind. And that's a maker. And programmers are more likely makers than managers. And what this means is, if you have a deadline, for example, the first exercise set for this course is due before the next lecture, then don't start 2 hours before, right? You don't have the time. It's rather better to work in a what I call open-end setting. And then oftentimes, more often than not, you are basically done a lot faster than you thought, but just the knowledge that you have basically endless amount of time, might give you the ease in your mind to come up with a solution. And many solutions in the beginning, when you start to code, they are not as natural, right? It's not so intuitive. And then the last one is what I call phase iteration. So what is phase iteration? Usually, what we do here in this course is I give you like a linear sequence of stuff every week. And you study, study, study. But then you don't build anything. You do small exercises, but you don't build a product or something. The thing is, you learn a whole lot by going in this linear process, but then you don't learn to ship a product. So what you should do, maybe in the summer, maybe whenever you have time, is say, I want to do a project, for example, for your thesis. You might want to do an analysis involving data that you don't have. What could you do? You could build your own scraper and just scrape the data. That's how we started our business back then. So, and I had no knowledge of how to do this, and I learned so much over that. All the problems that you could run into when you scrape data, for example, people checking your IP address and blocking after 100 requests, and then your scraper basically dies because it's blocked. Things like that. This is things that you cannot teach in a course. So it's important that you find those projects and always work. And then, because I call it phase iteration, it means you're going back and forth between the two phases. So, for example, now I'm working on another project with Fedora. And once I'm done, I will get a new book, because I will do something else with Fedora, and I reread a book. So I will also go back and forth between a project-based analysis and then some tutorial or course or book. That's important. So that ends the introduction part. And now I would say, let's go to coding. So what I will do, I will quickly show you. This is now chapter one, the intro chapter. And we can see when you open it, you have like the book format, you have lots of text. I will quickly go into the presentation mode. But before we do that, I want to show you something, how you can move along in a notebook. Let's say I select the header here. And now, what do I mean by select? Well, we see there is a frame around the cell, the code cell. Now I use my arrow keys to go up and down. And let's say I want to go I don't want to move along the cells, but I want to go inside the cell to maybe make a change. I just hit Enter, and now I'm in the cell. So now I can edit whatever is in the cell. For example, here it says the chapter one heading. And there is this pound symbol before. And this pound symbol, one pound symbol, means header of, you know, the highest order, so to say. So if I want to make this header a header of a lower order, I could say, for example, let's put in three more pounds, so I have 4 pounds. And then the heading will be formatted in a smaller way, right? And I can go back and do it back. This is a text cell, or also called a markdown cell. And this is how I formatted this book. And this is also how you can format your answers to the exercises. So you should, of course, document the answers to your exercises. And that's how we do it. And then the question is, how do you create a new cell? Well, let's just, I'm now in the first cell again. And I'm not in the cell, I'm on the cell, so to say. So I go in the cell with Enter, and I go out of the cell with Escape. Or I have to execute it. But that's it. And now let's say I want to have a new cell below it. What I do is I just press the button B and creates a new cell, right? And now I'm on the cell. How do I see that? Because I don't see a cursor. I can go in by pressing Enter again. And now I could write the Python that we've seen before by just saying hello world. And then the question is, how do you execute the cell? You cannot do that with Enter, because Enter we use to get into the cell. So what you do is you press Control and Enter, and then the cell is executed, okay? And note that I stay in the cell. I could also do Shift and Enter, and the cell gets executed again, and the cursor or the focus jumps to the next cell. So this is like navigating in a Jupyter Notebook. And let's say I want to create a new cell above the current focus. Well, how about just push A? If B creates a cell below, then A might create a cell above. That's creating cells. And then maybe the last thing you want to know, how do you get rid of the cells again? Well, you just put your focus on the cell, and then you press the button D twice, and then the cell will go away. And you do it one more time, and the cell is going away. So this is like a 1-minute introduction to how to work in Jupyter Notebooks. And now we will continue with the content. So the question now is, what's a good example? So I tried to come up with a good example, and then with which I can show you some things, and for which I can also tell you some story for how you can maybe solve it in a different way. So let's say the example is, I give you a list of even numbers, I give you a list of just whole numbers, and then I ask you to calculate the average of all the even numbers in it. This sounds like a very simple task, and it is. But let's say I don't tell you the list yet. In the example, we will see the list is rather short. You could do this by hand. Now, the problem is, this list could be very, very big. In fact, it could be so big that the list does not fit into your computer's memory. And then the question is, how do we do this? And averaging even numbers, given a list of just numbers, and assuming these are whole numbers, can be broken down in 2 steps, right? We can first go over all the numbers and just select those that are even. And then once we got the even numbers, we can do the averaging. But then average, how do we do averaging? Well, we have to go back basically to our very first lesson in a statistics course, where we basically defined the average, or the arithmetic mean, to be the sum of the numbers divided by the count of the numbers. That's how we average. And of course, we need to teach Python to do that. And then of course, there might also be, you might also have the question that, let's say, if we know anything about those numbers, anything about the structure of those numbers, maybe we can exploit some nice properties. For example, if I tell you, we look at the numbers 1 to 12, just whole integers, 1 to 12, a range, or as a mathematician would say, a series, then maybe you could find a way to derive a formula where you just plug in the, let's say, the largest number in the list, and you can get back the number, the solution. This would be a so-called analytical solution. And this is usually what you do in math when you take calculus. So when you take calculus, where most of what you learn is about deriving the slope of some function or the area under a function, you derive formulas out of formulas. This is analytical thinking. And oftentimes, this is enough to get a solution. It's important to understand that most of the time, if you can find some analytical solution to some problem, this might be the best solution you can find because you don't have to calculate. You can derive the number by some argument. Now, the thing with analytical solutions is, how do you filter out the odd numbers or the even numbers or some numbers? You know, that then it gets tricky. And this can be worked out, but then this would require you to have a little bit more advanced math knowledge. And this is when programming is super useful. This is the example. So I give you a list of numbers here. And trust me, it's the numbers from 1 to 12. It's only whole numbers, but they are not ordered. And this is what I just meant by, is there any structural assumption we can make about the data we are given? So obviously, there is no structure. All we can say is we have a list of numbers, and they are whole numbers. That's it. They're not ordered. And because of this, we cannot come up with a formula to find a solution in an analytical way. And therefore, we want to go ahead and write a computer program to solve our problem. So that's the type of thinking, of the storyline behind. If we could find an analytical solution, we would prefer that, but we cannot do that. And then I just executed the upper code cell here without telling you any of the rules yet. So what this basically does, the single assignments, the single equation sign here, is it assigns a new variable called numbers to a list of numbers. And then, of course, because a computer has like a memory, what we can do is we can look at the variable numbers and we will get back the list of numbers we entered. This seems super simple, but regarding lists, it's actually not so easy as we will see later in this lecture. So far, so good. We have found a way to model the data in our program. So let's write some code. This is basically the code that implements the story that I told you. You're given a list of numbers, and you first have to filter out some. In this case, we have to filter out the odd numbers to only be left with the even numbers, and then we have to average them somehow. So now, how do we average? A very first naive way is, let's go over all the numbers one by one. And how do we do this? This is done by this for loop here. And we will discuss for loops in great detail in lecture 4 and 5. So there is a lot of theory behind the for loops that is basically not visible here yet. And then the next line of code, which says if number, and then there is the percent sign 2, and then there's a double equals, and then a 0, and then we must not forget the colon at the end. That's also important. This also means something. And this may be the first line of code that does not look so intuitive to you. So I have to explain it a little bit. So what does the percent sign do? This is basically what is called modulo division. So it's basically the division that gives you back the rest of a division. So if you have, let's say, 7 divided by 2, you will get 3.5. But if I ask you what is the modulo division of 7 by 2, then the answer would not be 3.5. The answer would be 1. Why 1? Because the number 7 divided by 2 fits in there 3 times, and then there is a rest of 1. So 2 times 3 would be 6, and then we still have a rest of 1. So that is what the modulo division is. And we will also look at this later. So what this does here, modulo division by 2, is a rather a special case of doing modulo division. It divides a number by 2, and if there is, and you know, gets the rest. So the rest, if you modulo divide any number, any whole number by 2, there can only be 2 outcomes. The outcome could be 0 or 1. It would be 0 if there is no rest. When is there no rest? Well, there is no rest if the first number is perfectly divisible by the second number. Otherwise, there would be a rest, and the rest has to be 1 because we are dividing by 2, and the rest cannot be more than, you know, the number by which we divide. So what I focused here, numbers modulo divided by 2 will end up being 0 or 1. And then I have a double equals here. And we've also seen the single equal sign before. So the double equal must have a, you know, a different meaning in a way. And it does. The double equal basically is asking Python to compare two things with each other and then tell us yes or no if they are the same or not. And the single equal sign that we see in the beginning is what we've already discovered before. It's assigning something, namely the thing on the right-hand side, to the variable on the left-hand side. So we must always be careful in the beginning to not mix up the single and the double equal signs here. And then let's go to the next block of code and try to understand what goes on here. Well, this is basically implementing the logic of calculating an average. So what this does is, first it keeps track of a count, which starts to be a zero, and then for every time when we hit an even number, we increase count by 1. And then the second variable called total is our running total. So we start also at 0, and then we add up the individual number that we loop over. And then at the end of the day, the total will be some number. It will be the total of all even numbers, and then we divide it by the count of all even numbers, and that's the definition of an average. And how do we get the average? Well, at the end, I calculate it. I say total divided by count, and I assign the result to the variable called average. So I execute this cell, and note how nothing happens. So how do we know that a cell is executed? We know it because it says now the number 5 in the upper left corner. That means it was the 5th code cell that was executed in this running program here, but we don't see any output. Now the question is, why don't we see any output? So, or in other words, how could we see an output? So let's say in the last line of the cell before, we had the variable called average, and we assigned to it. And now if I ask Python, hey, what is average? Python tells me it's 7. So Python seems to know what the average is, the average of all even numbers from 1 to 12. It's 7, but we have to ask it, right? It doesn't print it to us. And the reason is, as we will see later below, because of the single equal sign here, we call the entire last line to be a statement, something that changes the state of the running program. And by just typing only average here, this is not a statement. Here we are just asking Python, hey, give me something that you have in your computer's memory. And so the upper cell changes the memory, the lower cell just asks for what is in the memory. And this is why Python does not print out the result of the first cell. And to go into a bit more detail regarding, you know, what we see in Jupyter notebooks and what don't we see, here's another example, 2 lines of code. And you might wonder, well, is this code? Why is this code? Well, the answer is it is, of course, code. This is Python's way of modeling text data. So this is called a string. So we write the double colons here, the double quotes, and then we just write some English word here and or words. And we do so in the second line as well. And if I execute this cell, I will only get back the second cell. So we learned, what do we learn from this? Jupyter notebooks give us back only the value of the last line. And then there's a trick. If for whatever reason you don't want this output, just put a semicolon at the end. This will suppress the output. Now the question is, how do we get the output of the first line? Well, there is no way to do so unless we print it out explicitly with, for example, the print function. So this is the same code cell from before, just within the print function. If we execute this, we get back 2 lines of output now. Yeah, that's how we get output at any point in time in a program, if you wish. And you will use lots of print statements in the beginning of your programming career, because you will mess up some program, you won't understand some value of a variable in between your calculations, and you want to see some intermediate results. And what you could do is you can always just put in a print, and then you will see all the values that are calculated as you go. And now, let's continue by looking at what is called operators. So operators in Python are symbols that have a special meaning to Python. For example, arithmetic operators like plus and minus. So here in this cell, I add two numbers, 77 plus 13. Python gives us back 90. Subtraction also works. So we can use Python as just a calculator, right? Just as your, you know, average Excel spreadsheet or physical calculator, whatever. This is just a calculator. But I want to show you a little bit what happens in memory if we execute this first cell. So this is how to teach you a little bit how Python works in memory, which is important to understand. When we execute the first line, when the 77 is executed, what Python does in the memory section, somewhere in memory, and memory you should always think of, you know, just a big space in your computer, some conceptual space that has addresses, so we can put something in there. And what we can put in a computer's memory will always be ones and zeros, and then we can read it out. So what happens is we will put something here, and we don't know what is in this box, but whatever is in there means the number 77. And then Python will go ahead and will create this when it reads this, and then it will read the 13, and it will put a 13 in another box. And then this is how it evaluates. So it goes from left to right, but it doesn't. It basically skips the plus. And then once it has created those two numeric objects in memory, we go ahead and then it says, let's do the plus operation. And then what Python does, it will create a new thing, a new object with the numbers 90 here. And this is then, and I use dotted lines here, given back to us. And that's it. And now the question is, what happens if I execute this cell again? Now we see the number 12 next to it because I run it again. So what happens is, in the moment the first 90 was given back to me in Jupyter Notebook, Python immediately forgot this because it was not stored. So it was calculated in memory. It was there. The ones and zeros were there in memory, and it was given back. And then when we execute the cell the second time, what Python does, somewhere else in memory, it creates a new 90, and it gives us back. And then we can see it in Jupyter Notebook below the cell as out here. But then in the moment we see it, Python immediately forgets it. So that's how memory works. And of course, only in this very basic example, but we will come back to that later in how we can actually create verbs and what happens in memory then. Let's first continue a little bit with the arithmetic operators. So the upper two code cells here is what is called a binary operation. Binary because there are two operands, two numbers that are added or subtracted. The minus, of course, we can also use as a so-called unary operator, which basically goes ahead and flips the sign. So I execute a cell minus one. And I tell you a little bit of how Python does that in memory. So what happens if Python reads this line? It goes ahead and it first creates the number one in memory, plus one, okay? And then it looks at the operator, and this operator says, give me back the minus one. And then Python is smart enough to figure out a new object called minus one. And this is given back to us. And once we read it down here in the cell, down here, it gets immediately forgotten, and the plus one is also forgotten. So whenever we don't have a way to reference those objects that are in memory, they are forgotten. And of course, by the way, those up here, they would also be forgotten right away. So this is an example of what we call an expression. This is something that something happens in memory, but it has no side effect. So what that means is we can execute all the three cells again. And this might sound super weird to you in the beginning, but we get back the same results. And the same results we get back with different objects. So every time we execute, new objects are created and given back and immediately forgotten. So that's an important concept. You should always remember how the memory works, because this will basically solve 80% of your bugs in the beginning. And it will get a little bit more tricky. Then multiplication and division also works. just as we expect. But now here we see an example of something that we have not seen before. We have, but I haven't pointed your attention to it already. So I divide 84 by 2, and I get back 42.0. And I multiply 2 by 21, and I get back 42. So the first one is obviously a whole number. This makes sense. If I multiply two whole numbers, I get back a new whole number. But what happens if I divide two whole numbers? Well, obviously, in this case, it could be a whole number, but Python doesn't know. So Python says whenever you divide two whole numbers, there is a good chance that what the result will be, it's not a whole number. And because of that, Python takes special care. So what Python really does in memory here, it first creates an object 42. And what it does, it tags it by saying int for integer. And in the second case, Python goes ahead and creates this huge box, comparably huge, and I'm exaggerating a bit, but exaggeration is important here. It puts the 42.0 here, and it puts something other here, namely float, because that's a floating point number. So what happens in memory is, for us humans, there's a number 42. We don't care how this is stored in memory, right? But in a computer, the bits, the ones and zeros in memory, they matter. So there's a big difference. And we will see that the number 42.0 as such is super imprecise. So this is actually not 42.0 exactly, even though it appears to be 42.0. But this could be, let's say, 41.999999 and so on. We don't know. It's shown to us as 42.0. But in memory, maybe there is some imprecision. We will see about this in future lectures. So let's go on. How can we avoid this, you know, the result to be a float? Well, we can use two divide by signs, two slashes. So we can say 84 divided by 2. And the double slash means integer division or whole number division. So now the problem is 84 divided by 2 will give us 42. But what happens if I divide 85 by 2? Well, the answer is, it must give me back also 42, or 43 maybe. It cannot give me back 42.5, which is what we would expect. And why can it not do that? Well, because Python knows, or Python is created such that the double slash will always give you back an integer, a whole number, and a whole number cannot model 42.5. So it has to make a choice here. And at first sight, it seems like it's rounding down. Why is it rounding down? Well, maybe because the periods, the decimals, they are cut off. So if you look at 42.5 and you cut off the dot 5, then you are left with 42. This could be the explanation. However, it's not as easy as it seems. Let's divide 85 minus by 2. We get back negative 43. So last semester, someone said, well, this is just always rounding down. Well, obviously, it's not rounding down. Well, it is rounding down, but it's not going to rounding down the absolute value, but it's always rounding towards negative infinity. And these are, you know, things that you should have in the back of your mind. You know, you should know what you should take from this is, if you know that you get back an integer, then don't use numbers that, you know, will not, you know, where it does not suffice to have an integer. These are sources of mistakes. And then, of course, as we have seen before, the percent sign is used to give us back the rest. So 85 modulo divided by 2 is 1. Why? Because 85 divided by 2 is 42 plus 1 rest, and that's the one we get back. So we have now seen three different ways of doing division, and you should, you know, always remind yourself what you do. Now you might wonder, the modulo division may not be super useful for you as business students, right? We will find many, many applications where modulo division is super useful. One we have already seen, to check if a number is even or odd, we just modulo divide by 2. And another one is, let's see if 49 is perfectly divisible by 7. How do we do this? Well, we just use modulo division, and if the rest is 0, then we know the first number is perfectly divisible by the second number. And then there's even more use cases. And for example, modulo division by 10 or 100 will help us to get back digits from the end of a number, like 123 modulo divided by 10 gives us back the last digit. Modulo divided by 100 gives us back the last two digits. This may be useful if you want to extract, let's say, I don't know. You can also turn this around, of course, but let's say you have some number and you just want to extract the millions out of it or something. This could be useful. And then there is something, it's called diffmod, which does both of them together. So 42 and 10, diffmod will give me 4, because 42 divided by 10 is 4 and rest 2. So I read it again, 42 divided by 10 will give me 4 and the rest of 2. Makes sense, right? Now, one thing that is important here, diffmod, this is not an operator. This is what's called a function. So syntactically, this is something different. But we will come back to that soon. Of course, exponentiation works. This is 2 to the power of 3. We use 2 stars. And then, of course, we can go ahead and chain the operators. So we can say 3 to the power of 2 times 2. And now the question is, what's the order of precedence? And in this case, Python is very much hands-on. It works exactly like you would expect it from math. So 3 to the power of 2 goes first, and then the result is multiplied by 2. So this is 18. And if you don't believe me, you can always put parentheses to group stuff, and then the parentheses will be calculated first, and this also follows the same rules that you all know from math. And of course, we get back a different result if we group differently. So now comes a big topic that you have to understand. So let's see, get a new piece of paper here. We have seen all three types of data before now. And now what I do is I create three variables called A, B, and C, and I assign them three different things. And now let's see what happens in memory. So when Python goes ahead and reads the first line, what it does, it goes to the right-hand side first, it looks at 789, and then it will go ahead in memory, and it will create a box, and it will put ones and zeros in there, because every box in memory, in a computer's memory, always has ones and zeros. Don't worry about the ones and zeros, I won't ask you that on the exam. You just have to understand there is some layer of abstraction here. And the ones and zeros, they mean the number 789. And then, as we have seen, Python marks this back and gives it a type. It says that's an integer. Now, the object is there. But now we only have evaluated the right-hand side of the assignment statement. The A equals part is still missing. So what happens is Python goes ahead now, creates a name called A, and makes this name point at this object. Okay, then we go read the second line, and Python goes ahead, makes a bigger object, more space. It says, that's a floating point number, float, and then it will put 42.0 here. And then in the next step, it will create a variable called B and make it point. But note how I go ahead and I draw the object on the right side, on the memory side first, before I create the name. So if something goes wrong on the right-hand side, if this, it's a 42.0 here, creates an arrow, then the B will never be created. Okay? And now let's do the last line. So this will be probably even more space. And now we write something here, str for string. You will see in a moment, and we write in there Python rocks. And then once this object is created, we create the variable C, make this point to the object, and then we have our model in the memory. So this is how you should think of memory. Let's go ahead in the slides. So one thing I want you to know, and this will for sure be an exam question, every object has three properties. The first one is the identity. So let's call the ID function in Python with A, B, and C in it, we get back some number. What I want you to understand is the number we get back, not meaningful. You can as well ignore that number. The only thing what this number means is this is basically the spot in memory here on the left-hand side where it is. So you should think of the memory like this. The memory goes, it's based like a matrix. So we go from left to right, row by row. And every cell, so we can think of the memory maybe like this. We can think of the memory going like first cell, second cell, and these are different spots, and it goes like this. And memory is one-dimensional. So I have a piece of paper here which has two dimensions. A computer's memory is one-dimensional. So once we hit the end, the memory just continues. And this will be the first, you know, cell in memory, the first one or zero. So this might have the number zero because we start counting at zero, as we will see soon. So this is like the first address in memory. And we go back there, and this may be, I don't know, 20 million, because our memory has many, many ones and zeros. So we have, nowadays, the computers have big memory. So this may be a very big memory representation here. And the number you see here in the code, this is, you can think of, this is the number at which the object begins. That's the location in memory. It's an address, okay? Other than that, it has no meaning. So if two objects have the same address, they are the same object. It's literally the same ones and zeros we look at in memory. That's the lesson here. That's the first property of three. The second property, let's first check how we can actually check this first property. Let's say I create a new variable called d789. What I will do here in memory, let's see if I still have space. Let's say I create a new object and 789 int, and then I make a variable called d point at this. That's what I did in this line of code that I just executed. And then the next code cell, I asked Python the question, is A equal to D? And the answer is true, it's correct. So what does a double equal do? As we saw before, it looks at the left-hand side and the right-hand side and says, hey, you two, are you equal? So what does equal mean here? It does not mean the same object. It means potentially two different objects in memory that have the same ones and zeros inside them, okay? And now let's look at our diagram of the memory. We see we have A pointing at an object and we have D pointing at an object, and both have the same ones and zeros inside them. This is why we get a true here. But then there is another operator, and note how this is an operator. By the way, the double equal is also an operator. So what I'm saying is Python has a lot of non-arithmetic operators, and the word is itself is an operator which checks identity. So up here, we check for equality, and down here, we check for identity. So the question is A and D the same object? And the answer is no, because A and D point to two different objects in memory, which is why I get false here. So the notion of equality and identity are two different notions, and we must never mix them up. The second of the three properties, every object has a type. This is now not surprising. A is an integer, abbreviated with int, and B is a floating point number, abbreviated with float. And that's exactly what I wrote in the memory diagram at the you know, to label the box, so to say, or the bag. So that's my view, that's how I think of memory. I just think of many, many bags in memory that have a label associated with them, int and float in this case. The label indicates first how big the bag is and also what the bag can do. And let's see. Let's look at B. B is a floating point number, and we can check if B is a whole number as well. So what we do is we write B, and then we write dot, which is also an operator, by the way. and it's the so-called attribute access operator. So B is an object, but B comes with properties, and one property among them is the presence of this isInteger function. And we can call this function by just saying B.isInteger. So what this means is we ask B, hey B, are you a whole number? That's what we do. And we get back the number true. And that makes sense because the ones and zeros that are inside could be represented as an integer type without losing any decimals, okay? And because of that, the answer is true. To contrast this, maybe I create a new cell and I call it a variable BB, and let's say, let's make it 42.1, execute this. Oh, one. See, I make the mistake also. So let's create a new variable BB pointing to the number 42.1. And now we can ask BB, hey, are you an integer as well? And the answer will be false, because we would, if we converted this into an integer type, we would lose the decimal. And now here's the trick question. What do you think happens if I ask the integer A if it is a whole number? Who thinks it's a good idea? Who thinks we get back the answer true? Okay, so you haven't downloaded my slides before or not done the reading, because everyone who has done the reading knows that there must be an error. And the reason is because what the mistake you just made is you try to answer my question in a semantic way. So I asked you, is the number, I don't know, 789 a whole number? And you said, of course it is. But we have to look at this from the point of view of a computer, of a software. And the software just looks at the ones and zeros, and it has to make sense of those here, of the ones and zeros inside. And for the integer type, 789, we already know it's an integer to begin with, because that's how we defined it. So there is no point in asking an integer, are you a whole number? Because we know for every integer, it's a whole number. So that's why it's maybe a trick question. But yeah, it's important to understand the idea of type. And then what's the type of C? It's str, which stands for string. That's the default way of representing text in Python. And what can we do with string types, string objects? Well, we can say, well, please lowercase yourself. Please uppercase yourself, and so on. Okay, so depending on the type, we have different functionalities. And now there's the third big property of every object, which is the value. And now the value, this is, it looks very trivial, but there's an important point behind it. So if I just ask Python, hey, what are A, B, and C, it will give back to me what I entered them to be in the beginning. So there are two points. First, whenever we ask Python, let's say, what's the value of A in this case, it gives me back 789, some presentation. I copy it, I create a new cell, I paste it in, and it does not create an error, okay? And that's important. So what I now have is I have A that points to the number 789, and I get back a representation, a value, that I can use to create a new object that has the same value. So when I enter 789 in the second cell, what happens in memory is a new object of type int is created, and Python immediately forgets it. So we create it, and it immediately forgets it. So the important lesson here is it's two different objects with the same value, okay? And we call this the literal representation. Literal meaning we can literally type it into Python and Python understands it. That's what a literal is. And whenever we ask a variable, what's your value? Also, a subtle difference is, a subtle thing to note is the variable A does not have a type. So when we say Python, what is A? Python goes in the list of all names, it looks up A, and then it goes to the int object, and then it gives us back the value of this object. So a variable never has a value. It's the object that has the value. So a variable points to an object that has a type and a value. That's how we should think of memory. And usually the value, as I said, is something that we can copy-paste back into Python, and Python literally understands it. And also the second notion about value is that is now the semantic thing. When I say the word semantic, I mean what do we humans think of this? So for us, you know, Python rocks is text. We don't care if it's called string or whatever. For us, it's text. The number B is 42.0. We don't care how this is represented. And we will see many, many ways to represent this number with different data types, but they all mean the same thing. And whatever the meaning is to us humans, that's what I think of as the semantic meaning or called the value of an object. So value has the semantics with it. Okay, let's continue a little bit. So far we have seen how Python works, and I've already made some mistakes along the way where we saw error messages. And let's formalize this a little bit. So whenever something goes wrong in the computer programs, it is always a case or an example of one of three different types of errors. And that's also a nice exam question, by the way. That's an error. What type of error is it? And then one of the three possible answers is it could be a syntax error. So what is a syntax error? Let's say I want to build an accounting program or a finance program, and I want to add $2 prices. And I write 3.99 plus 10.40, which could be prices of products. I add the dollar symbol behind it. I try to execute it, and I get back syntax error. So that's what a syntax error is. You type something, you execute it. Python immediately says, I cannot read this. I don't understand what you mean. That is a syntax error. And syntax is the computer science term for grammar. So, you know, in English language, a noun can be a subject or an object in a sentence. This is what we understand of grammatical rules. And there is something similar in the programming world, which is called syntax. And syntax means how can we use different things, or what can we do such that Python understands what we mean. And what we cannot do is use invalid symbols, because otherwise we get a syntax error. And we also see the little arrow here. Python tells us exactly where the problem is. It says, I don't understand the dollar symbol. Okay, there are other types of syntax errors. The one that you will most likely make at the beginning is you will forget a colon here, and then you will get a syntax error because in the for loop, Python needs a way to know when the line when the first line of the for loop is done, and when the body of the for loop continues. And this is done in two ways. It's usually done with a colon, and then also with indentation. But if I put a colon here, this line works. And then also here, as I just noted, now I have the colon, but I don't have indentation. And if I execute this, I get an indentation error. An indentation error is also a type of a syntax error, because Python obviously doesn't know how to deal with it. That's one type of error. The other time that will most likely be more common, or I hope it's more common, syntax errors you should not see after maybe the first 2 or 3 weeks. So in the beginning, you will make lots of syntax errors, but once you got the syntactic rules down, you will usually write code that works, that runs, but then oftentimes something else goes wrong. And the something else that can go wrong is usually a so-called runtime error. And the best example is, what is 1 divided by 0? And the answer for us humans would be, it's undefined. So, and undefined is again a semantic meaning to us. So it's not like one divided by zero has no meaning because it's a natural law or something. It's basically a convention by mathematicians, but it's something that we understand as a semantic mathematical meaning here. And then in Python, if you try to execute this, you get a zero division error. So why is this not a syntax error? It's not a syntax error because, let's say I divide by 0.001, I will not get an error. So if I divide by any number close to zero, it works. So syntactically, the code is correct. But once I have a zero here, divide by zero doesn't work in Python because it could be made to work, but then what would you get back? And we will see a result other than an error in a future lecture. So you have to be careful. You do not get this type of error all the time. You have to know that you get this error, or you have to also know when you don't get this error, even though it's wrong. But that's a runtime error. And then the third type of error is called a semantic error. And I have already talked a lot about semantics. And when I mean semantic, a semantic error is something where the computer doesn't see an error. The computer just does what you tell the computer to do. But the thing that you told the computer to do is wrong in and of itself. So in other words, your code is wrong, but it doesn't cause an error. Or in other words, you get back a result that you didn't intend to. So what that means is, let's look at the intro example again. And what I did here is, in order to calculate the running total, I would always add total plus the number, the current number that is even, right? But let's say I make a copy-paste error, because we type a lot and we copy-paste a lot of time, and we make just a simple, stupid copy and paste error by putting the variable count here instead of number. If I execute this, I don't get an error. But the answer is, of course, wrong, right? Why? Because the code is wrong. So that's an example of a semantic error, right? The code works, but the result for us humans would be wrong. And there's a famous example that this where this has happened in practice. NASA, they tried to send a satellite to Mars, and some programmer or engineer, he did not use meters, but he used feet. And then the satellite or the Mars, I don't know what it was, but it tried to land on Mars, but it burned once it approached Mars. And the reason was because a human mixed up meters and feet. That's a semantic error, right? The computer is not to blame here. It's the human that made the mistake. So let's look at best practices. The same example rewritten as you would rewrite it in 3 or 4 weeks from now. This looks a whole lot different. So for example, instead of a for loop, we write the for loop inside the brackets, inside the list. This is called a list comprehension. It does the same thing as a for loop with a list in it, but we will look into that in detail in a later lecture. Then we have an intermediate result here called events. And then we take events and we sum it up and we take the count. And we can do this with so-called built-in functions called sum and len. And we can do this to calculate the average and get, of course, the right result. But this avoids writing, taking the count ourselves and calculate the running total and then know about the calculation manually, basically. But this is the best practice. And why is it the best practice? Because the code is much cleaner. And also, the sum and the len function, they do the counting and the summing up faster as well, because they are built into Python and it's just faster. If you ever want to know what are good rules to know, just type import this and you will get some best practices back. You can read them at home. Some of them seem to be a joke, but they really aren't. And the interesting thing is, and this is also why I think why I made the distinction between programming and computer science in the beginning, some of those practices here, they actually contradict each other. And in a science, you shouldn't have different theories that contradict each other because only one can be true. But in an art, you may have different ways of doing something, and all is good. So that, this is why this is an example of this. Okay. Let's look at some harder example. And if you understand what I'm about to do on the next memory diagram, then you already understood a big concept. So let's first look at A and B here. We just set them to two different numbers. And now the interesting thing is, what I do here, so let's say I create the float, big box, 20.0, and I write float here. And then I say A points to here. And then when I say in the next line, A is set to the integer 20, what happens is Python will create a new object with less ones and zeros. We'll also write 20 here. Will make the reference here go away, and will make A point to this. And this may be confusing for the ones of you that have some experience with other programming languages, usually the type of something is in many, many programming languages associated with the name. But in Python, the type of the things is associated with the object. And the name is only the thing that points to the object. So in Python, it's perfectly fine to change the type, so to say, of a variable. But that's actually, you know, bad English here, because when I say I change the type of A, what I really mean is I create a new object of a different type with the same value, because 20.0 in float and 20 the integer have the same value semantically for us humans. So I create a new object of a different type, and then I make A point at the new object. That's what I really do. So what I do as a shortcut saying in English, I could say I changed the type of A, but really I didn't do this. In memory, something else happens. And then I can do things like this. I can do the assignment and the operator in one statement, which is called update. So I can go ahead and I can take the 20 and multiply it by 4 and set it back to 20. So what this does, this line, it will create 20 times 4, which should be 80. So it will create a new integer. And then it will erase this reference and make a point there. The next line, the double slash equals by 2, what this does, it goes ahead and it divides the 80 by 2 to create 40. And it does not create a float. Why? Because I use double slashes here. And then it deletes the reference here, makes a new reference to this. And now, by the way, what happens with those objects that have no reference anymore? What happens here is we don't know what happens. We have to assume they are gone, but Python doesn't delete them right away. So in regular intervals, Python does what is called garbage collection. It just goes ahead, looks at the memory on the right-hand side and checks, is there something on the right-hand side that has no reference to it? And if it finds something, it goes ahead and deletes it. It removes it. And once this is deleted, we can actually reuse the memory. And Python does this for us. If we were to learn about other languages, for example, C or C++, we would have to do this deleting of objects ourselves often. At least we have to, you know, think a lot harder about how we arrange the memory. Python does all of this for us automatically. And then in the last step, I take A and I add 2 to it. So what this does, of course, it creates the number 42, the solution to everything, deletes this reference, and then creates a new reference here. And maybe it deletes this one here, but maybe it doesn't. We don't know. So this is how those lines of code work. And at the end, when I evaluate A, oh, I just executed the cell before twice, unfortunately. So now I have a 44. But we can quickly fix it by just going back and running all the cells again once. And then we will end up with 42. And this is what happens in memory. So this is always what you should have in the back of your mind. You don't always have to, you know, draw this diagram so extensively, but it's really helpful to know how to do this in cases where something goes wrong. And now I will show you a case where something goes wrong. But before that, I will also tell you another secret. Let's say you call the line before, it created the number 789, an integer, and made B point at it. This is what B does. And now I can evaluate B, and it's the number 789. But then there is the stealth statement where I can delete B. And then once I delete B, what happens is this gets deleted on the left-hand side. The right-hand side, again, is not touched. It may be collected by the garbage collector. It may not. But once we reference B again, B is, of course, gone because we deleted the reference, the name. If you're ever in doubt what names are there, just type in dir and call the function. Then you will see all the names, and you will see there are many, many names. It's actually shortened here, so output is limited. And now comes the hard example with which I want to conclude today's lecture. Let's say, let's go back. Let's start again. Just to give you B I deleted. So let's say B is now 789 again. So I create 789 integer. I make B point at it. And now I say B is equal to A. That what I just said is actually wrong. What I should have really said is, I said, oh, we should have done this the other way around. So should have done A here, beg your pardon, we put an A here. And then we will go ahead and execute the next, say B is equal to A. And what this does, it creates a new name, B, that will also point at the same object. And that's an important idea. Two things pointing at the same object. And if I now go ahead and set A equal to 123, this will create a new object of type int. It will delete this reference, make A point here. And now if I go ahead and I say, what is A? A is 123 because I just created it. But when I say, what is B? It's of course still equal to 789 because I never changed where B points at. And that's an easy example because an integer number cannot really be changed in memory. Now I give you the harder example, but it's the same thing happening. So I do the same thing, the same trick, but it just gives you a little bit of a weird result. So let's look at the list again. I create a list, 1, 2, 3. Now the question is, we haven't drawn a list yet in memory, so we will do that. How does a list look like? Well, when Python reads this from right to left, it will go ahead and create a big thing here with slots here. And how many there are is not important. Type list. And then it will go ahead and create an int object, or three int objects, 1, 2, 3. And make the first slot point here, the second slot point here, and the third slot point here. And once this is done in memory, it will create a name, x, and make x point here. And now in the next line, I set y equal to x. So what this does, I create a new name y, and I make it also point to this list here. And now the confusion begins. First, how can I access those numbers? There's a new notation that we haven't seen before, but we will see in detail in future lectures, called indexing. So I look at x and the zeroth entry, the zeroth element. Python starts counting at 0, so 0 really means 1. So if I write x 0, what happens now? Python goes ahead and checks where is the x, where does x point to? X points to this list, and then evaluates the subscript 0, the index of 0, and it follows this pointer to the 1. This is why I get back the 1 here. And now, what happens if I change this? Let's say I set the number 99 to this number. So what this line does, it creates a new number 99, a new bag, integer. It deletes the reference here. And the first element will get a new reference now pointing to the 99. I can see this by printing out x. So the first element was changed from 1 to 99. And now the big question is what is y, right? But the answer is obvious now. And why is the answer obvious? Because I drew the diagram. So y, of course, is also a pointer to the same list. So y is pointing to the same thing. And if I ask what is the first element in y, it will be 99, of course, because I'm following the pointer to the same list. And then I follow another pointer to the 99. So now the thing is this. I have two different names, and I made a change via one of them, via the x, and I can see the change via the other variable, namely y. And this could be a source of confusion if you start to code some of the examples problems you will see in the next couple of weeks. Because what you should always keep in mind is that more than one variable may be pointing to the same object. And whenever this is the case, nothing can go wrong if the object to which you point is simple, simple like an integer, but a lot of things can go wrong if the object we point to is an object that can be changed in place like a list. So we will see a lot more lists in the future, but for now, I think we leave it with that. And always make sure that you understand what goes on in memory. Okay? So it's now 11:15. Regarding the assessment and so on, you have seen on Moodle, you have online quizzes, and the first two ones actually are due tonight. I actually wanted to make those assessments due before the lecture so that I force you to just have the reading read before the lecture. But then I figured, okay, maybe someone cannot do that, and maybe someone needs to, you know, have some clarification question or something, so let's make the assessment deadlines always on the day of the lecture at midnight, but it's always after the lecture. And only for today, you have two quizzes, but it's really one quiz. I just split them up in part zero and part one, like in the introduction part and the first lecture part. And then I will also send an announcement with the coding exercise, and the coding exercise will always be due to the next lecture. And how can you do the coding exercise? You are allowed to work in groups up until from one to three people. So you can do it on your own, you can do it with three people. In the past, I had people send it to me via email. What we will try to figure out today is to find a way where you can export the Jupyter notebook that you work in into a PDF and then upload the PDF on Moodle so that I have an easier time to correct everything. But Moodle so far hasn't been used to create custom groups that you create. So far, always the teacher had to create the groups. And I don't want to create the groups for you. I want you to create the groups. So we will figure this out. And then other than that, I will see you on Thursday, I think. Thursday, we have E102 already in the schedule, but I know IPC is also empty around the same time. So most likely, the lecture will be here in IPC. And without that, if you have any questions, just speak to me after class. And I will also stop the recording so you can start with the bad jokes again. Stop.